I want you to open your Bibles today to the book of 1 Peter, please, chapter number 2, as we continue our study in 1 Peter. Today we're going to be looking at chapter 2, verses 6 through 8. Once again, I think that these are some very difficult verses, but with the help of God, I think I can explain these in a way that we can apply to our lives. I read a story a while back about a college freshman. It was a true story. And this college freshman had just completed his first semester in school, and he had a little break, and so he came back home. And when he came back home, he scheduled an appointment with his hometown pastor. And when he got back, he met with his pastor, and he shared with him, he said, "I wanted to be the first to let you know, and I wanted to tell you this," but he said, "In my first semester at school, I've been enlightened by my professors, and I just wanted to tell you that I no longer believe in God." And so the pastor asked him, "Well, could you tell me about this God that you no longer believe in?" And so he sketched a caricature of God, and he said something like this. He said, "This God is unloving. This God is unfair. This God is pretty much lacking in essential goodness." And the pastor said to him, "Well, I guess we are in the same boat, because I don't believe in that God either." And most people today who do not believe in God, they do not have a clue what the Bible actually says about God. And really the very sad thing is that there are so many followers of Christ who have way too low of a view of who God really is. The Bible portrays God as good, as gracious, as kind, as loving, as merciful, and benevolent. As a matter of fact, Psalm 52, verse 1 says that the goodness of God endures continually. You see, God is the infinite and the inexhaustible resource of all goodness. Everything that is good comes from God. There is no good in the world apart from the touch of God. You remember that James one time said that all good and perfect gifts come down from our Heavenly Father. And so we could say that the goodness of God, it's exhibited in the beauteous wonders of His creation, but also in His mercy that He extends towards sinners. And I think that all of us would agree that the greatest expression of the goodness of God is the gift of salvation, which culminates in eternal life. And you know, you and I are so privileged to have the opportunity to know this God who is so good. And last Sunday morning, we were looking at 1 Peter chapter 2, verses 4 and 5, where we talked about, and I asked the question, are you privileged? And today I want to kind of carry on with that theme by talking about the subject, yes, we are privileged. And that's what we see in 1 Peter chapter 2, beginning with verse number 6. In verse number 6, Simon Peter says, "Therefore it is also contained in the Scripture." So he's quoting the Word of God. He says, "Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect, precious. And he who believes on Him will by no means be put to shame. Therefore to you who believe, He is precious. But to those who are disobedient, the stone which the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone and has become a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble, being disobedient to the word to which they also were appointed." Now, I think that there are at least four things in this passage of Scripture today that are pointed out about God that help us understand what kind of a gracious and good God that He really is. And the first thing that He points out, I think, in verse number 6, is just simply the fact of our amazing Christ. If you were to say to me, "Pastor, who is Jesus Christ?" I could say that He is amazing. And that is what Simon Peter is pointing out here. You see, until our thoughts of Christ are elevated, did you know that our walk with Christ, our worship of Christ, and our witness of Christ will be limited? One of the reasons why our worship of Him is not what it should be and our walk with Him is so inconsistent is because our thoughts of Him are not elevated to the sanctified place that our thoughts of him need to be elevated. And so Simon Peter says, for those of you who do not have a high view of Jesus Christ, let me tell you about four things here that'll help you to elevate those thoughts. In verse number 6, he mentions two things about the Lord Jesus that I hope we'll get a hold of today. Number one, he says that he is the cornerstone of the church. Therefore, it is also contained in the scripture, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect and precious. And he who believes on him will by no means be put to shame. And that obviously is referring to the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, what is interesting here is that Simon Peter gives us a direct quote from the Old Testament. It is a quote from Isaiah chapter 28, verse number 16. And that tells us that Jesus Christ being the cornerstone of the church, it was not simply a New Testament doctrine, but it was foretold way back in the Old Testament. As a matter of fact, all of the prophets said that when the Lord Jesus Christ, that when he came, that he would be this cornerstone, this foundation, you might say, to God's new spiritual house, which would be the church. And that is where the presence of God would then dwell, abide, and reside. Now, the reason that's so important is because in the Old Testament, we know that the temple was the place that was God's house. The temple was the place where the presence of God dwelt. And so if the people wanted to find God, they wanted to worship God, they wanted to be where God was, they would go down to the temple. That is the place where they would worship. But you see, then came along the New Covenant and the New Testament. And when the New Testament came along, there was a different structure, you might say, for the presence of God and where it dwelt. And now the presence of God would reside in individual believers. And those individual believers, they are the ones that comprise, that make up the church. That's where the presence of God dwells. And that is why the Apostle Paul could say in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse number 19, that now, that our bodies are the temples of the Holy Spirit. Now, the reason that is so key is because that as glorious and wonderful as it is, that because now the Holy Spirit of God dwells in my heart, dwells in your heart as a follower of Jesus. And as glorious as the truth is, that means that the worship of God is no longer contained in one centralized sacred place, but you and I can worship God anywhere because wherever we are, we carry with us the Spirit of the living God. But as true as that is, I believe that the New Testament consistently teaches that when God's people listen, gather corporately, that wherever they gather corporately in a local church setting, that the glory of God dwells there because that's where God's people are and they carry within the Spirit of God. Now, friend, if we believe that, here is what that does. That helps us to keep from taking the church for granted. That keeps us away from, talking about the church or criticizing the church or disparaging the church in any way. Because when God's people gather together corporately in the church, that is the place where the glory of God is residing because we brought the Spirit of God, the presence of God in the church with us. Listen to 1 Corinthians, for example, chapter 3, verse number 16. And Paul here is addressing the corporate body of believers at Corinth. And he said to them, Do you not know that you, the church, you are the temple of God? And the Spirit of God dwells in you. So that if anyone defiles the temple of God, God will destroy him. For the temple of God is holy, which temple you are. He's describing the corporate body there. And he's speaking about the local church that was in the city of Corinth. And so while it is true that you and I, we can worship on the golf course, on the lake, we can worship in the backyard, there is just something special when there is the corporate body that gets together in a place to worship God. And I think he manifests himself and his presence in ways that he will not in any other way. So the very fact then, listen, that the Holy Spirit indwells you and the Holy Spirit indwells me. So corporately, as the body comes together, the Holy Spirit is in this place. What that tells us, friend, is listen. Sometimes we look at the church today and we say, man, what's the church going to be like 20 or 30 years from now? I can tell you, the church is going to be just fine. Why is that? It is because it is God's house. It is God's institution. It is God's structure. So no matter how difficult the circumstances are that the church might face today, no matter the intensity, listen, of the persecution or the satanic attack on the life of the church, God Almighty will never abandon his church when it's built on, listen, the cornerstone of his Son. And his Son has given the promise that, hey, I will never leave you and I will never forsake you. And so really our real concern today is not that the presence of God won't be in the church. You know, I've actually heard people pray before, oh God, we plead that you would show up today. There was a guy in my former church who used to pray every Sunday if I called on him to pray. He'd pray, God, I want you to show up today and show out. You know, asking God to show up in the church is ridiculous. Because if the Holy Spirit of God indwells us, he's already here. That would be about as ridiculous as you walking up on this platform this morning and saying, Pastor, I beg you, show up today. I'd say, dude, I'm already here. You don't have to beg me to show up. I'm here. We don't have to beg God to show up when we come together for worship. He is already here. Our issue is not getting God here. Our issue is getting our hearts in the right place and our spirit and our attitude what it ought to be so that we will be able to worship him in spirit and in truth like he deserves and he desires that we worship him. And so you see, we see our amazing Christ. At number one, he is the cornerstone of the church. And I did a little investigating about that word cornerstone, and it really enlightens us as to who Jesus is to the church. Because that word, that one Greek word for cornerstone, it was used in three different ways back in that day. And so when Simon Peter used the word cornerstone, their thoughts would automatically go to this. And as I mention these things to you, I want you to just identify that with the Lord Jesus and who he is to the church, which highlights how amazing that he truly is. Number one is the word meant the base stone, the base stone. Now, in modern architecture, the cornerstone is placed at the base of the corner of a structure, and it literally unites, brings together, ties together two walls of the structure. Symbolically, it speaks about the foundation of that building. Now, when you relate that to the Lord Jesus, what Simon Peter is saying is that it's Jesus Christ and him alone who ties us together as the family of God. Friend, we are not tied together by our love for the Gators or the Seminoles or the Hurricanes or the Elephants or any other thing else. We are tied together, listen, by our commitment to the Lord Jesus Christ. And if that does not tie us together, I want you to understand we are standing on sifting sand because nothing will tie us together like the Lord Jesus Christ. He is the one that brings our unity. So the cornerstone, then it spoke of the base stone. But it also, secondly, and I like this, it was a word that spoke about the keystone in an arch. The keystone was what completes the arch and holds the rest of the structure together. It was the very topmost stone. That is who the Lord Jesus is to the church. He's the topmost personality of the church. Do you realize that the church has no strength or spiritual cohesion apart from the Lord Jesus Christ? He's the one that gives us our strength. He's the one that gives us our cohesion. And the building or the church that we might say, it must be tied together, listen, by the leaders and the members' submission to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. That's what makes the church strong. And if I as a leader and other leaders are not submitted to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, and if you as church members are not submitted to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, I don't care what else we have in this place. I don't care how much money we have. I don't care how beautiful the facilities might be. What gives us our strength and our power is a submission to the Lordship of Jesus Christ. And I really am afraid that so many churches today have drifted away from that. They're about everything but that. We are about one thing and one thing only. Lord, what would you have us to do? You are the Lord of this house. You are the Lord in this place. But that word also spoke about the capstone. The capstone, what was the capstone? It was the highest stone in a pyramid. And what is interesting is that only one stone could fit in that place. Did you know that it was the capstone of the pyramid that determined the shape of the rest of the structure? Now, you just relate that to the Lord Jesus. He's the only one who can occupy the position that he holds. No one can take his place as being the authority over the church. And just as the capstone determined the shape of the rest of the building, listen, it is the Lord Jesus Christ that determines the characteristics of this institution. In other words, we get our character from him. We get our directions from him. We get our orders from him. We get our mission from him. When it comes to morals and values and ethics, we don't look to Hollywood. We look to the cornerstone. When it comes to marriage and family and how to raise children, we don't look to secular psychology. We look to the cornerstone. When it comes to what is right and what is wrong, we don't look to the norms and the mores of culture. We look to the cornerstone. He is the one that determines the very characteristics of the church. He is the Lord of the church. So he is the cornerstone. But the Bible also says that he is also, listen, the chosen of God. Verse number 6, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone who is elect. And the word election there just simply means to be the one who is chosen. I like the fact that when he quoted Isaiah 28:16 in verse number 6, he's speaking for God here. And it's God who says, behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone. So the very fact that Jesus is the head, the Lord, the Savior, the sustainer, and the supporter of the church is not the invention of man, but it is the very decree and the plan of God. You know, when I think about the Lord Jesus Christ, I would tell you that man, he has some impressive resume. I mean, he was born of a virgin. He lived a sinless life. He died on a cross. He was raised from the dead. He ascended back into heaven on a cloud. Bible says he's coming again. He has one impressive resume, doesn't he? You know, when an employer goes out to hire an employee, usually the first thing that employer does is that employer gets a resume. And that resume tells a whole lot about the applicant that he's considering hiring. Tells him how old he is, where he went to school, what his skill set is, what others think about the applicant. And very seldom does an employer just pick up a resume, look at the resume, and then just, boom, immediately hire the person. Normally, they check out the references. They want to see what others say about him. And they want to see if the person is really the one that he has read about on paper. And then normally an employer, just by looking at the resume, calling the references, still won't hire the person until they actually schedule a personal interview. And they sit down and they talk with him. Friend, I want to tell you, you and I are so very privileged as followers of Jesus Christ, because we don't know him by simply reading some resume about him. We know him by having a personal interview with him and a personal experience of him. You see, there's no one like this amazing Christ. And so we see, number one, the reason we are so privileged is because we have an amazing Christ. But there is a second reason why we are so privileged, and that is because of our absolute confidence. Number one, our amazing Christ. Number two, our absolute confidence. In verse 6, therefore, it is also contained in Scripture, "Behold, I lay in Zion a chief cornerstone, elect and precious." Now mark this, "He who believes on him," Jesus, "will by no means be put to shame." That word is translated in some other versions as disappointed. And the idea is putting your hopes in something, but then having those hopes dashed because of whatever it was you put your hope in, or whomever you put your hope in, they let you down. But what he's saying is that, hey, when we put our trust in Jesus Christ, we're never going to be put to shame. We're never going to be disappointed. I know of no one who truly is a follower of Jesus Christ, and Jesus is their Lord and their Savior, who has ever been disappointed in him. You know, I've been disappointed in myself. I've let myself down. I've disappointed others. I've let them down. I've had others disappoint me. They've let me down. But in the 42 years of following Jesus Christ, I have never been disappointed in him. Never. Friend, Jesus Christ does not disappoint. Jesus Christ satisfies. Jesus Christ fulfills. I look back over my life since I have known him, and I have come to him, and I've needed forgiveness, and he's always come through. I have come to him, and I've needed comfort. He's always provided it. I've come, and I've asked for peace and counsel and guidance and direction, and he's always given it. I've come to him in moments where I needed hope, where my world was turned upside down, and the Lord Jesus has given me hope. I've come to him when I needed assurance that everything was going to be okay, that God loved me, that he was for me and not against me, and he's always given me that assurance. Friends, we are privileged because of our absolute confidence that we have in the Lord Jesus Christ. And you see, because of that confidence, we have assurance because we know. We know that we cannot fall off of the structure that is built upon Jesus as the cornerstone. Now, we know these verses. These verses are so amazing, and God can say it a lot better than I can. So listen to what the Lord said about our security. Romans chapter 8. "We know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are the called according to his purpose. For whom he foreknew, he also did predestine to become conformed to the image of his Son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Moreover, whom he predestined, them he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. What then shall I say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? He who did not spare his own Son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Who shall bring a charge against God's elect? It's God who justifies. Who is he that condemns? It's Christ who died, and furthermore is also risen, who is even at the right hand of God, who also makes intercession for us. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation or distress or persecution or famine or nakedness or peril or sword? As it is written, for your sake we are killed all day long. We are accounted as sheep for the slaughter. Yet in all these things are we more than conquerors through him who loved us. For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord." Friend, there's assurance in that. But did you know that we will never live with present security until we are convinced of our eternal security? What is it that convinces us of that? Jesus. Jesus said in John chapter 10, verse 27, "My sheep hear my voice, I know them, and they follow me, and I give them eternal life. They shall never perish, neither shall anyone snatch them out of my hand. My Father who has given them to me is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of my Father's hand." I give them eternal life. When does He give that? The moment we believe, the moment we come to Him, trusting Him as our Lord and Savior. At that moment, He gives us eternal life. And that is why we have this absolute confidence. Why are we so privileged to be saved? It's because unsaved people don't know this amazing Christ. Unsaved people do not have this absolute confidence. But there's a third thing that proves our privilege, and that is our affectionate response. Our affectionate response. Now, because our Christ is so amazing, because He has given us His absolute confidence, down in verse number 7 of 1 Peter 2, the Bible says, "Therefore, to you who believe, He is precious. To you who believe, Jesus is precious." Not only is Jesus precious to the Father, He is precious to the Father's other children. And so we have this amazing privilege of loving the Lord Jesus. And that is a reciprocal relationship. We love Him, He loves us. In fact, the reason we love Him is because He first loved us. And unsaved people know nothing about that. Have you ever experienced being in the presence of God alone, just loving on Jesus Christ? No privilege like that. Do you love Jesus? Friend, I want to tell you the most important question I could ask myself is, Craig, do you love Jesus? That's the most important question you could ever ask. It's not, Craig, did you do your homework in preparing a sermon? Craig, did you come to church? Craig, do you love Jesus? To me, that's the great dividing line in life right there. Do I love Jesus? You know, Jesus had something to say to a church in the book of the Revelation that seemingly, man, they had it all together. And listen to what He said. "To the angel of the church of Ephesus write these things, says He who holds the seven stars in His right hand, who walks in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks." Jesus said, "I know your works, and I know your labor, and I know your patience, and I know that you cannot bear those that are evil. And I know that you have tested those that say that they are apostles, and they are not, and have found them to be liars. And I know that you have persevered, and that you have had patience, and have labored for my name's sake, and you have not become weary." Man, what a group of believers. Then Jesus said, "But nevertheless, I have somewhat against you." They were busy in their service. They were orthodox in their doctrine. They were patient in the midst of persecution. They were serious about their sanctification. But Jesus said, "I've still got something against you. And what I've got against you is you've left your first love." Friend, I want to tell you, we can have heads filled with Scripture. We can have feet that are busy in service. But if our hearts have become hard, cold, and distant, and we just don't love Jesus, we need our spiritual batteries recharged. Because there is nothing that can replace a love for the Lord Jesus. And friend, I want to tell you, if you and I, if we really love Jesus, we're going to think about Him often. As a matter of fact, he's going to occupy what's going on in our mind throughout the day. We're going to spend time with him consistently. We're going to talk about him regularly. We're going to live to please him if we love him. Jesus said, I love my Father and my food is to do the will of him who sent me. Let me ask you an honest question. Do you live to please Jesus or do you live to please yourself? And your answer to that question tells me whether or not you really love the Lord Jesus, because if we love him, then we're going to live to please him. Do we love Jesus? Do we really love him? You know, I love my bride, and the reason I love my bride is not because of what she gives me. I love her because of who she is. She's my wife, and I love her. She is the mother of my children, and I love her. She's the grandmother of my grandchildren, and I love her. She is the greatest saint I have ever met, and I love her. I don't love her because of what she gives me. I love her because of who she is. And friend, I love Jesus Christ because he is my Savior. I don't love him because of just what he does for me or what he gives me. I love him because of who he is. He was born of a virgin, lived a sinless life, died a substitutionary death on the cross, arose from the grave. He ascended into heaven. He's coming back to get me. I love him because he's the Lamb of God and the light of the world and the Lion of the tribe of Judah and the lily of the valley and the bright and morning star and the fairest of 10,000 to my soul. I love Jesus because of who Jesus is. And you see, dear friends, if you and I love Jesus, that's what he's asking for. That's what he's calling for. That's what he's expecting. Let me ask you, though, am I the only one that is the number one battle in my life that I have to fight? Just loving Jesus. It is so easy, I have found, to just get to the place where I just get so used to coming to church and so used to just going through the motions, standing up, sitting down, singing when I'm told, listening to the choir and the orchestra, preparing a sermon, getting up, doing my thing, just going through the motions. And yet, I find my heart becoming crusty and cold to where I just don't love him like I ought to love him. And that's what Simon Peter is attacking here. And he's saying, man, you're so privileged to have the opportunity to love Jesus. Unsaved people can't. They don't, but you can. Then he closes out in verses 7 and 8. With what I've simply called our abundant warning. Our abundant warning. Listen to these two verses. Therefore, to you who believe, he's precious, but to those who are disobedient, the stone that the builders rejected has become the chief cornerstone and has become a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble being disobedient to the word to which they also were appointed. Over and over and over and over again, Scripture warns us, both Old Testament and New Testament, it warns us what happens when we reject God's chief cornerstone. And the reason that he warns us, listen, I want to make this point, is because of his abundant goodness. You see, it's not God's will that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. And so because of his goodness, because he loves, he warns us what happens if we don't do what he says. Just like you parents, you warn your children when there's danger ahead because you love them, that this is going to be the consequence if you do not listen to what they're saying. And that is what Simon Peter is saying here. And dear friend, the warning is, here's what happens when anyone rejects the gospel. What is the gospel? The gospel is good news, right? But did you know that there are two sides to every story? Because not only is the gospel good news, it's only good news to those who receive it. It's bad news to those who don't. It's good news to those who say yes to the Lord and submit their lives to Him. But it's bad news for those who do not, because there's an accountability to the gospel once we have heard it. I think Simon Peter, and I wouldn't say these things if they weren't right in Scripture, and I had to be obedient to God's word. He mentions there are two reactions. Those who react in faith will never be put to shame, will experience eternal life. But those who react in unbelief, they will be put to shame and they will experience judgment. He talks about two ways, that Jesus is either the stepping stone or He is a stumbling block. Friend, I tell you with a broken heart that those who do not come to Jesus Christ, bow before Him in repentance and faith, will stumble over Him into hell. That's what Simon Peter is saying. He's either a stepping stone or he is a stumbling block. When it comes to Jesus, there's no such thing as neutrality. He is either Savior or He is Judge. But He's nothing in between. How in the world is Jesus Christ a stumbling block? And by the way, Simon Peter's not the only one that said that. Paul said it in 1 Corinthians chapter number 1. Said that He was offensive to the Romans, a stumbling block to the Jews. How is Jesus Christ a stumbling block? Because there is no way to bypass Him and get to God. The only way to get to God is by coming through the Lord Jesus Christ. And so those who will not receive Him stumble over Him, and ultimately they miss Him. And that is why verse 8 says that He has become an offense. Friend, did you know that Jesus Christ really did not come to bring peace? Jesus came to bring division. Matthew chapter 10, verse 34, "Do not think that I have come to bring peace on earth. I did not come to bring peace, but a sword. For I have come to set a man against his father, a daughter against her mother, and a daughter-in-law against her mother-in-law. A man's enemies will be those of his own household. He who loves father or mother more than me is not worthy of me. And he who loves son or daughter more than me is not worthy of me. And he who does not take up his cross and follow after me is not worthy of me." See, Jesus came to bring division, a division between those who believe and those who do not believe. That's the only two camps that God sees, those that are believers and those who are unbelievers. And you see, dear friends, the reason Jesus is a stumbling block is because, listen, the singularity of His message, "I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. No man comes to the Father but by me." That is an offensive message. Jesus is an offensive and a divisive figure. And He's offensive and He's divisive because, let me tell you something about Jesus. Jesus demands total allegiance. He'll be the cornerstone or He'll be nothing. He is not content to be a brick in the building. He is the building. And one of the greatest challenges that the church faces today is trying to be relevant to reach a new generation of skeptics with a message that is so divisive and a Savior that is so offensive. Because He declares, "There's no other way but me." And friend, you and I as believers are never to be offensive. We're to be kind. We're to be gracious. We're to be loving. We're to make sure that our behavior does not offend people. But I'm here to tell you that if you and I embrace the Christ of the Bible and we proclaim His commands, that's going to offend people. And if the Jesus that we represent never offends anybody, we better check out which Jesus we're really representing, because he will bring offense. So you see, there are two ways. But then he says that there are two destinies. Two destinies. In the B part of verse number 8, it says that he was a stone of stumbling and a rock of offense. They stumble, being disobedient to the word of which they were also appointed. They were appointed to that. The word there is the word destined. They were destined to that. You see, there's one cornerstone, but there are two destinies. One group has eternal life. The other group has shame and judgment. What he's pointing out are the eternal consequences of rejecting God's only cornerstone for the gift of salvation. See, friend, if we don't heed the truth, we will embrace a lie. It's kind of like somebody doing a math problem, and that person just rejects all of the principles of mathematics. They are destined to get the answer wrong. And if we reject God's plan for salvation, then we have been destined, listen, not for eternal life, but for eternal death. And man makes that decision, not God. God's good, God's gracious, God's kind, God's merciful. But we must accept God's plan. See, it's the cause, it's the law of cause and effect. For every cause, there is an effect. The cause is if we place our faith in Christ and Christ alone, the effect is eternal life. But if we do not, the effect is damnation and judgment. And that's not God's fault if anyone experiences that. Over in 1 Kings chapter 6, I think it is around verse 7, there's an interesting verse that says that when the temple was constructed, that they took all of the stones in the quarry, and they hewed out the stones and they cut them to fit perfectly in the place of the structure, so that when they actually built the temple, that no hammer was ever heard, because all of that was done back in the quarry. And there's an old Jewish tradition that says at the very beginning of the project that the workers in the quarry sent a stone up to where the project was that was to serve as the cornerstone. But the people that were constructing the project, they did not know that, and so they didn't see any place for that stone, and so they just pushed it aside. They rejected it. And over time, moss and vines covered up that stone, so you didn't even see that it was there. And when they came to the very end of completing the structure, they were missing one stone. And that was the cornerstone. So they sent word back to the quarry, send us up the cornerstone. And the workers in the quarry sent the word back to the workers at the project. We sent it up at the very beginning. And then they began to think, oh, that was the stone that we rejected, that we pushed aside. And so they uncovered that stone, put it in the cornerstone, it fit perfectly, and the project was completed. You see, friends, God has a plan for your life and for mine. That plan is that our life might be completed by taking us to heaven when we die. But if we reject God's cornerstone and push him aside, that plan will never be completed. And that's not his fault. That's ours. He's given us ample warning. Is he the cornerstone of your life? Have you said yes to him? Have you been born again? Would you stand, please? Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed and no one looking around. If God's spoken to your heart today about the need for a Savior, you come today. We have counselors that will be standing down front. All you need to do is to tell one of our ministers, I want to give my life to Christ today and be saved. You're here today. God's led you to be a part of our church family. We invite you to come today. you're here today, you need prayer, someone to pray with you or for you, but you come today. Now, Father in heaven, oh, how I pray in Jesus' name that those of us who are saved today would realize how blessed and privileged that we are. For those who are not saved, I pray that they would understand today they can be saved, but the only way is to come through the Lord Jesus Christ. God, I pray for those that you have led to be a part of this church family. God, I pray that they would respond and come today as well. May you be honored and glorified in our invitation. In Jesus' name I pray.
I'm so glad that you've chosen to tune in to our broadcast. And it's the prayer of my heart as you have walked into our worship center by way of television that you have been encouraged as you have listened to the great music that's been provided by our sanctuary choir and orchestra, and as you have listened to the instruction that has come from God's Word, that you really have been strengthened with something that will help you in your walk with God. And if you have yet to discover the wonderful gift of salvation that is provided to us through Jesus Christ our Lord, I pray that you might call upon His name.